Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I'm the educator for adult learning at the St. Louis Art Museum. Thank you so much for joining us for today's program, Seeing and Being Seen, a conversation with photographer Jess T. Dugan and their sitters. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. To get us started, I will hand things over to Eric Lutz, the Associate Curator of Prints, Drawings, and Photographs, and Hannah Klemm, the Museum's Associate Curator of Modern and Contemporary Art, who will provide a brief overview of the related exhibition. Thanks, Hannah and Eric.
Thanks, Jessica. Good morning, everyone. Jessica said, I'm the Associate Curator of Photography here at the museum and co-curator of the exhibition, Currents 120, Jess T. Dugan, along with Hannah Klemm. So this exhibition opened in mid-September and it runs through February 20th. The museum has unfortunately been closed for 3 weeks because of the spread of Omicron, but does reopen next Tuesday. So there'll be another few weeks to see the show if you haven't already. We are all extremely pleased at the reception the show has gotten. It was featured in a New York Times article, in Review and Art Forum magazine, and just last week was included in the brief but spectacular segment of the PBS NewsHour. Jess gave a talk at the opening of the show, which you can still link to on the museum's website. And for this presentation, which sort of bookends the show, we wanted to delve in a bit to the process and to the dynamics of portrait photography, in part because much of Jess Dugan's recent work was taken in St. Louis locales and featuring St. Louis sitters. So we are very fortunate that two of these sitters, Collin, Elliott and Shira Berkowitz, are willing to share their time and their experience and their insights with us today. It's very, very generous of them. So with that, I wanted Jess and Collin and Shira to briefly introduce themselves, and then we'll delve into looking at some images and some interesting questions around the making of those images. So I think I'll turn it over to Collin and Jessica, if you could go to the next slide. Take it away, Collin.
Sweet. Good morning, everybody. My name is Collin Elliott. I'm an artist and designer based here in St. Louis, which is my hometown. And a lot of my work is centered around portraits, landscapes, and the artifacts of home.
Shira?
Thank you. I'm Shira Berkowitz. I'm a social impact artist and a printmaker. I'm also located in St. Louis and have been a professor of art history and printmaking at Flow Valley STLCC.
And Jess.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. I like this little pattern of all of us popping up with our video one at a time. It's kind of charming. Thanks so much to everyone for being here. Thanks to Eric and Hannah for all your work on this show and organizing this program. And huge thank you to Collin and Shira for being here with us this morning. I'm super excited about this conversation. My name is Jess, obviously, and I'm a photographer. I've worked almost exclusively with portraiture for the past 15 years or so, and I've spent a lot of time thinking about the ethics of portrait making, the interplay between photographer and subject, and then the eventual effect of that on the viewer, what this process does for me as the maker, what it does for the subject. And so I'm really excited to dive deep into this conversation.
Jessica, if you could go to the next slide and the one after that. There we go. So two images that are prominently included on the first wall of the show. And then if we go to the next one. So I'd like to kind of kick off this conversation ask both Collin and Shira just to give a little bit of background information. How did you come to meet Jess and start to work together? A little bit of background on what that process was like, and maybe going into what was it about working with Jess that made you feel somewhat comfortable about the process, if we're to judge by the final images where there is this real sense of kind of intimacy and kind of openness presented there. So maybe starting with you, Collin, since we have some behind the scenes shots here.
Yeah, so I became familiar with Jess's work while I was at school. I was at St. Charles Community College and I was working on my AFA program in graphic design. And so it was just like really amazing to see like this large body of work where I was able to see like several people at rest. And so got a chance to connect with Jess and, you know, we were able to begin making portraits in my own home space. And so that was very comforting just to be able to be in a relaxed space that was familiar for me. And over the course of time, we've just, you know, made some portraits both in my home space and very nearby spaces to my home. So, you know, whether it be like a park nearby or, a space within my apartment or home, it's just kind of been like a very relaxed pace. And, you know, the process itself has been very, very smooth, very, very comforting. So it's been the first portrait that we made here on the left was in 2017. And this was in my mother's home in the house that I grew up in. So it was kind of like a very special moment for me to have this this portrait of myself at this time.
Interesting.
And Collin, I'm just going to jump in for a sec. I know you said we met in a class and, for me, when I'm trying to choose people to photograph, it's always based on a kind of energetic connection. And when I met Collin, I was immediately drawn to him, but you were part of a group. And I remember trying to be really careful how to ask you alone if I could make pictures with you in that kind of setting. And I was really thrilled when you said yes. And like you said, the one on the left was the first one we made. And I remember, cause you'd seen a presentation of my work. And I remember when I showed up at your mom's house, I think one of the first things you said to me is you said, "I've already talked to my mom. She knows I might be naked." And I remember telling you, you didn't have to be naked. And we settled on this pose, but I always think about that when I see this picture on the left. And then of course the one on the right was, as you mentioned, in Bitten Park near your house.
If we could go to the next slide and Shira, if you kindly jump in here.
Happy to. I guess kind of like Collin, I've known Jess as an artist here for a little bit since they moved to St. Louis, but was first really connected with them to be a sitter just a couple of months after my top surgery. I'm not quite sure exactly how that came about, but for me, there was this like opportunity to work with them that occurred at the beginning of my own journey of really feeling a desire to be seen. And not resisting the opportunity to be photographed anymore. So I won't like say that that's the beginning of my comfort in my own skin, but top surgery for me was this really complicated dichotomy of holding grief and joy simultaneously for me and navigating the potential of both so palpably. And they entered into my life at that time when I wanted to know more about both myself internally and from their eyes externally. And then said like yes to Jess out of the likeness in both of our experiences as an artist, as a non-binary trans queer person. It was already a formula for my own comfort in entering into that very intimate conversation with them behind a lens. And the first place that we photographed was my apartment. This is one of the second or the third places we had that was just on the street from there. And they had created a really comfortable process for me where there was this slowness in establishing what that conversation looked like between us, how to shift slightly just into the space. We always begun with like a conversation where we could catch up as people first and friends first. And I think that that like friendship that we were establishing set the groundwork for me, like wanting to continue this process of exploring spaces with them and being seen behind the lens.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. That's a really, really great, great insight into the process. I'm curious, as we'll see as we go through the program, a lot of the images taken with you, Shira, have water featured fairly prominently in you know, swimming pools or tubs, if there was a thought behind that, behind those settings.
For me, I think, so like, I don't know, this is a little bit intimate of a conversation, but for me, right after top surgery was the time when I felt most comfortable being topless and in the water. I was really drawn to like hanging out at the pool and finding my body in rest and expressed that through my Instagram. And I think that I connected with Jess in that regard. And one of their comments to me was like, wow, you know a lot of bodies of water and you're always in a pool. And so I was like, yeah, let's explore them together. So it was that.
Yeah, I'm glad you shared that, Shira, because I was thinking of your Instagram. And I think for me, I have a larger interest in water. I'm interested in it as a kind of emotional and psychological space and what it does to our bodies in that space, and thinking of it as something that's very fluid and thinking about how that overlaps with identity. So I'm definitely on a path to seek out water. And I do think, like Shira said, I knew that they had all of these amazing water locations and basically invited myself to all of the pools that I saw online. But I also think something really beautiful happens in that kind of space where it does become really relaxed and it does become really intimate, and something changes in our bodies when we're immersed in water. And I was really interested in kind of creating that space with Shira.
That's so interesting. Jessica, could you move forward a slide? Yeah, so as we've seen, both of you have worked with Jess on several shoots over a long period of time, around 5 shoots for Shira and 7 for Collin. Shira, could you talk a little bit about how the photo shoots changed over time? Maybe how you guys work together, choosing locations or poses, or just kind of delve into that process over time.
Definitely. So as I mentioned a little bit, I think the most palpable change in the series of photographs that we've done so far, and there's been 5 different sittings, is the time between of allowing myself to feel and be seen in my own intimacy within my body. And that happened over the duration of just the exchange of getting to know Jess as a friend, and growing more comfortable being seen by them and allowing myself to be seen. And I think my body has really adapted and shifted visibly how I express my identity, in the series of photographs. It's kind of a series of photographs that documents that shift in connecting intimately with myself that, that also explores like finding the comfort in having an exchange of a friend being on the other side of the lens. And I think a lot of that comfort is just as I, over the past couple of years, have been very comfortable taking up space in the world, we see a series of photos where I allow myself to deeply connect with that space that I am comfortable in. And I say that evolution in the series is also a conversation in the external intimacy that I have felt comfortable allowing people into. For example, in this exhibition, there's also a photograph of myself and Sarah. And there was this unfolding of myself allowing Jess's gaze to be seen or met with my gaze. But there's also this moment of letting them into that intimate space between my partner and I. And I think that there's a lot of beauty that unfolds in this very particular exhibition where there's two conversations in my series going on. One, the intimate space being held by two people, to an artist and a person, each seeing and having that the viewer be the artist in one perspective. And then the viewer witnessing the intimacy of how they show up in the exchange of my intimacy with another person. And so really allowing that queer invisibility to kind of come out in the duration of our series has been really beautiful to me.
I was muted, sorry. Shira, I love what you said. And I was thinking, looking at this picture too, that there's also a third kind of intimacy, which is you really letting me gaze upon you. And not necessarily having your gaze meet mine or having me look at you being intimate with another person, but you know, images like this feel significant to me at this moment in my practice because there is a shift in how that gaze works and leaving some ambiguity around what is made visible. And I think it's just interesting to think about that in light of what you just shared about how the other photographs of you function as well.
I liked it a lot. Yeah, you're exactly right.
Also, go ahead, Hannah.
No, go ahead, Jess.
I was just gonna sort of make a joke that Shira's one of the only people who would meet me at like 6 a.m. And
that was literally what I was gonna make.
When I, you know, I've been moving to photograph outdoors for, you know, personal reasons, but also when the pandemic hit, that really became necessary. And I was photographing at sunrise and sunset. And, you know, a lot of people will meet you at sunset, but not everyone will meet you at sunrise. And I remember this day was actually really kind of cold, which is interesting because it doesn't read in this image, but I was very grateful that you were willing to meet me that early. And also just experiencing the world and experiencing a public place when it was that quiet was really different than at the end of the day. To, you know, places at sunset tend to be populated, but first thing in the morning, I remember this was a really, really still morning.
Yeah, particularly very much so. And I think a trend in our series is always like, are you comfortable taking off your coat now? Okay, all right, this will just be like 10 minutes and then it's always like freezing water. Okay, you can put your clothes back on.
Well, we'll get to the hot tub photo, but I remember you were shirtless and I was in like a winter hat and a coat and
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, Jessica, can you go on to the next one? Collin, you've had even more shoots, 7 we have over a period of many years. Can you talk a little bit about that kind of trajectory of time?
Yes, for sure, for sure. I think, you know, one of my favorite things about the portraits that I've been a part of and just like Jess's entire body of work is that it just reminds me of rest. And for me, that's like really important for me to see, like not only as a portrait, but as a practice, because I incorporate that in my own life. And it's really amazing to see. I think that it's important to be able to see yourself at rest, and especially for this to be in a museum setting, for that to be something that's on view for everyone to see as well. So I think throughout our series of work, like I've always felt very comfortable. I've never felt like I was in a posture that was not natural or that was, you know, uncomfortable. It's always been at a relaxed state. So this portrait here is actually one of my favorites out of all the ones that we've made, and mostly just due to like my ties and history to the tub. It really reminds me of just growing up and, you know, memories of like my grandmother, my mother, my sister, you know, having these conversations with me about like soaking in the tub, sitting in the tub, and actually just utilizing the tub space for a place to just to calm my body, to relax myself, whether it's just like after a long day or after sport games or whatever it may be. But my ties to water, I don't know, there's just always been this comforting past that has led back to this tub. And so for Jess to be able to photograph this, you know, it's really special for me. And, you know, there's another image as well where it's as if I'm like leaving the shower, leaving the restroom. And yeah, it's just a very comforting space to be photographed in. So I think that's what I think about when I see the this kind of these series of portraits that we've made together, is just, you know, the relaxation, the comfort that I've been seen in. So yeah
I love that, Collin. And I was thinking too how you know, for me, with everyone I photograph, there is a process of us kind of locking into a groove together, locking into a certain kind of energy. But I think with you in particular, from the very first shoot, I was always really amazed at how you showed up with a really intentional kind of presence. And we found that space together. And one thing I just wanted to share with everyone is that, you know, for an image like this, we were photographing for a really long time. I think we were there for a couple of hours. And you and I usually play music when we make pictures together, and that's usually music that you bring with you. And so it's really interesting for me as an artist to work with someone who brings so much to that space as well. And I really felt like a lot of our shoots, we both went into a kind of meditative space with each other for really an extended period of time. And I felt that especially in this shoot and in this space.
Yeah. I think to add to that, each time that we've spent is, you know, it's felt very much like a collaboration. It was never something where I felt like forced or overly directed or, you know, anything that was, again, uncomfortable. And as an artist and someone who is like lending my image and my presence, it's like, that's really relieving and like very, you know, it's a great feeling to have in the process of making a portrait.
Jess, do you have locations in mind for people, or did you and Collin talk about the bath? That's so interesting that it really resonated with you. But, you know, this, we know from just talking to you that this is a bathtub in a private event space. So you had to find it, like in a kind of searching for, you know, locations. Did you see this location and think, oh, this would be a great shoot for Collin, or did it evolve out of conversations?
Yeah, you know, I think it's, I'm trying to remember exactly for this picture. I think it's a combination of those two. You know, I think with both Collin and Shira, our first shoot was at their home. And that is often where I'll begin with someone, if that's an option and if that's comfortable to them. But I think especially with people I've worked with multiple times, I do start to seek out specific locations to vary that. And I think Collin, feel free to jump in. I think we had talked about water as something that was meaningful to you too. And I knew about this location and I asked if you would be interested in that and if you would be willing to be photographed in the bath. And when you agreed, it seemed like the perfect fit.
Exactly. Yeah, I think it was, we just kind of came to the agreement that, you know, this would be a nice space to photograph in. You know, it was comfortable and I was comfortable to shoot in this space. So, yeah.
So,
Hannah, to answer your question a little more broadly in relation to the show as a whole, I definitely have been seeking out specific locations and also seeking out locations with particular light or particular color palette more intentionally. So this is certainly part of that. And we'll talk about that more with the other picture of Collin.
So Collin, what you sort of brought up in terms of this aspect of collaboration, I think leads into the next kind of topic that I really wanted to talk about. And that sort of has to do with the kind of unique, lost our PowerPoint for a second. The kind of unique qualities of portrait photography, you know, versus, you know, a still life or a landscape or, you know, photography of architecture, which is more of kind of a one-way street in a way that that portrait photography is, you know, a balance or an exchange or a dialogue. And on the one hand, you know, you have Jess, you know, interested in, you know, sort of directing to a certain extent and, you know, making a certain kind of pictorial composition, you know, thinking about lighting and color and a lot of aspects. And then on the other side of the lens, you know, presenting oneself to the camera and hopefully, you know, bringing, you know, qualities of kind of, you know, authenticity and a naturalness that can, you know, almost sort of seem like they don't, you know, always mesh up, or they that you can have a, you know, a very highly constructed setting in which to work in, you know, like in this case, a very kind of complicated pose that's arrived at. So I did want to look at these two pictures in particular, this that you had mentioned earlier, Shira, of you and Sarah, and then the next one, Collin, of you in the red room, which is this very, you know, kind of unusual kind of setting to work in. So I think both of these images bring up a lot of interesting issues at how these images were created. So I am really interested to hear about, you know, kind of you know, both sides of the camera for the shoots of these. So maybe starting with you, Shira, if we could go back to the previous image.
Sure. I think for all the shoots, though, like we've talked about how they're kind of manifestations of, do you know where we should go, or Jess has an idea of where we should go. This was one of those locations that I think Jess had sought out and wanted to create imagery there. And but in terms of like how the pose or the interaction is directed, it's really just a conversation. I find that incredibly welcoming. And Jess is always very forward about like, oh, how would you stand here? Do you think you would stand here? Would you sit? How would you place your hands? So there's like a forward of like, how would you be, just be here? And then to get something particularly interesting, I think, behind the frame, is when the directing comes in. But everything always starts with just a conversation to break down, like, can you imagine yourself here, and how would you take up space? What would you do with your arms, for instance? And so that's how we arrived at this photograph. This was the very last photograph of this series. There was a brick wall somewhere like right onto the right side of this photograph. And we had leaned against that brick wall for probably 40 minutes or so before the sun was setting. And we were like, wow, that the river out there is really beautiful. Do we think that's a good spot to go to just one more time? And it ended up truly, for me, even resonating as one of the most beautiful compositions I have with Jess.
Wonderful. Thanks, Shira. Yeah, you reminded me, I have a bad habit of saying just one more, and then like 200 more. But you know, I think this location was interesting for me too, because this was definitely a result of the pandemic. I know for sure that I would have photographed you two at home if that had been an option, but it wasn't an option. And this was a roof deck on a friend's art studio. And like you said, I remember we photographed for a really long time because the sun was setting, and this was not only the last portrait we made, but it was the really like very last burst of light that day. And there was this really quick but amazing moment where the light falling on the two of you was so soft and perfect, and that sunset was so, you know, just right on the edge of disappearing. And it came together beautifully. And I think going back to Eric's question, that talking about directing or being directed, I think I love what Shira said about foregrounding how someone would take up space, because that's something really important to me. And the way that I direct is always meant to get the person I'm photographing into a pose that is visually interesting, but also feels really unique to them and specific to them. And that my photographs, while highly formal, are responsive to that person or those people. So for me, there is a lot of directing. There's a lot of back and forth, but it's in pursuit of something really candid and authentic.
Yeah, we want to go to the next slide there. And I think we have two behind the scenes for this image as well. If we go to the next one, which may be kind of surprising to some folks to see what the larger space looks like in the On God Hotel here in St. Louis. And to see you know, what was carved out of that space and in the making of the photograph.
Yeah. So I think a lot of what I'm thinking about is just like availability and like the range of what that means, I guess. It's like, you know, was I available that day? And I think Jess does a great job of just like checking in to see like, you know, are you available this day? You know, how are you feeling? You know, there's a conversation that happens, you know, before portraits are made. And so in this case, there was also, you know, is this space at On God available? Are we able to like actually be able to photograph in the space? And we were able to. And, you know, as far as like the being a photographer, being an artist, and this time not being behind the camera and, you know, actually taking the photograph of being in front of the camera, it was also comforting to be in the process with Jess, as, you know, there was discussion of like, how does this image look? You know, how do you feel about your posture? Does this feel like a way that you would actually be, you know? And so, yeah, there's a lot of collaboration that happens there, but this space in particular, I think we both knew, as far as like the color and the power behind the color, like what could possibly happen, because On God, if you're not familiar with the hotel space, it's like, it's themed on every level. So there's like yellow rooms, there's green rooms, blue, and we landed and arrived in the red room. And so this, you know, you can kind of see like part of the image at the lower left end of it is like the bathtub as well. And so, you know, I wasn't thinking this far ahead as far as like this being in the museum space, but, you know, I do again think that it's important to like have imagery of, you know, people who look like me, you know, in a space that looks, you know, comforting. I don't think that, you know, a lot of times in our feeds, news feeds, or, you know, in media, we get to see like specifically like Black men at rest, or Black men entering a place where they're, you know, leaving a healing space. And again, like the bathroom, the restroom being that space for me, I feel like this really captures that moment. And so, yeah, I guess in a way, choosing and allowing myself to be seen in the museum is, you know, also to offer to other people who may identify with me that, you know, rest is okay, that you can have rest, that you should be able to be in a place of comfort. And yeah, this is literally just that, me in a room that, you know, isn't necessarily like my home space, but it is a space that is familiar to me as far as bathing and resting and utilizing that space as a, you know, a place to return to comfort.
Yeah, Collin, I love that you're talking about rest and comfort, because I think, you know, this is one of my favorite images of you. And I was interested in that space, thinking about color as a certain kind of emotion or psychology, and just interested what we could do with that. And also kind of using this, you know, maybe in real life, slightly overdone room to carve out this really kind of, you know, heightened environment where we could make a portrait like this. And so I love how the color interacts with your body. I love that light coming in from the window. But I think when I look at this, I think a lot about gentleness and you know, a longer term interest of mine has been, you know, gentle and expansive versions of masculinity and kind of opening that conversation up. And I think with both of you, actually, there's a gentleness that I'm really drawn to. And for me, I see that really intensely in this one, even in the way you're holding your hands and kind of the softness of that towel and the tilt of your head. And, you know, and again, this sort of behind the scenes workup, I remember we photographed here for quite a while and we also had music, and it was a long process of, you know, working our way into this photograph together. And I definitely remember the moment when it all just happened. There was a sort of magic, energetic wave, and then it passes and moves on, you know? But that definitely happened for me in this one. And then, yeah, Jessica, if you go to the next slide. I mean, I love these sort of behind the scenes pictures because I think it, you know, it maybe gives some insight into my practice, but I also just think it's interesting to see the difference between, you know, the reality of a space and the construction of a portrait or construction of a photograph. But, you know, when I walk into a space, I think Collin, you and I tried, I think I asked you to lay on the bed to just see how that looked, and it didn't totally work how I wanted it to. And there was a process of us figuring out where in this room we were going to make a portrait. And you can see in the image on the right, there's that gold fan thing. I'm not sure what that is, in the towel rack. And yeah, so we, you know, I moved all of those things and just kind of isolated this corner as a color palette, as a kind of environmental studio. And then the picture, to me anyway, is really all about Collin's gesture and pose and kind of that intensity, you know, isolated within this larger environment.
Yeah, I wanted to add one more note to this, because it was interesting that day I had this necklace on, which is actually my father's. And so, my introduction into photography as a practice was in 2012, which was when my father passed away. And so like my relationship with the camera was really just like a way for me to capture through pictures what was difficult for me to put in words. And so the fact that I had this necklace on, which I don't wear every day, it really kind of speaks back to me, to the point of like, you know, that healing nature that, you know, I was able to find through portraits and making photographs and all of that. So I thought it was interesting that I had that on that day. And I don't have the chain anymore, but I have the fist still. But I am glad that, you know, this is captured, because that was, you know, a very, you know, it's one of the things that I hold on to. And, you know, it's just kind of been a part of just being able to remember my dad. But, you know, to have this in a portrait as well is really special.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, these personal insights are really enriching these photographs in remarkable ways. So thank you so much for sharing that. I was always curious about the necklace, and it took me a while before I sort of focused on it, you know, how sort of unusual it was. You know, you don't necessarily step out of a bath, you know, wearing, you know, something, but it adds this extra dimension to this photograph. That's quite remarkable. This is fascinating conversation.
Yeah, Collin, I remember you brought a lot of outfits to this hotel room too, and then we ended up just using the hotel like blanket.
Yeah. I'm surprised you didn't use that plexiglass chair, you know.
I don't know.
So this, you know, really, you set this up beautifully, Collin. You both are artists. So can you maybe talk a little bit about, or expand a little bit on how your own practice, especially as a photographer yourself, and how you approach the world as a photographer, how this affects you being photographed in this experience?
Yeah, I mentioned earlier, just introducing a little bit about my work, that I think about like the artifacts of home. And for me, home is just like this expansive idea that isn't just physical, but it's a headspace as well. And so I think that I've thought about this more intentionally, like through grieving and going through that process. But, you know, a huge part of home for me is rest. A huge part of home for me is just like finding these practices that bring comfort. So, you know, this is just one of those opportunities where, you know, me being photographed, I'm able to share that as opposed to presenting my own photograph. But yeah, this, I think the theme throughout my work is home. And just like the expansive nature of it. So I try to embody that and bring that to, you know, each practice, each art practice.
And Shira, same general question, but it's interesting that your practice is in printmaking and social practice, which are, you know, different mediums. Do you see their connection to your work with Jess, or do they inform each other in any way?
Most definitely I do. I think for me, my work deals with telling my story and stories of those with a likeness to me. And so Jess's work resonated really deeply with me already. The biggest difference, I'm not a photographer, and photography speaks so intimately of humanity that often in social practice work, we're not speaking that intimately, and we're not, there's layers behind how I orchestrate stories that don't reveal quite as much as Jess's photography reveals. So I think, being an artist on the other side of Jess's lens really has taught me different boundaries around how much I'm able to express or desire to express in my own work. Like a lot of that work manifests itself in like telling stories to our elected officials who don't, who have not given us the same rights as human beings. And so there's a new layer of vulnerability I feel here that I've been able to tap into just by allowing these conversations or even this like kind of like photographic collection of poems to exist in a way that a lot of my written work does.
Yeah, I love what you both shared. And I was just thinking it's interesting for me to work with people who are artists too, because I mean, I'm always interested in collaboration, but I think with both of you, there was an added layer of collaboration because you really understood what I was doing in a different way than someone who might be less versed in art making. And I really welcomed and appreciated that exchange.
I know that we want to leave some time for questions. We've already got some good questions coming into the chat, but I wanted to ask one more question. And both of you have touched a little bit on this topic, but I am curious, you know, what it feels like to, you know, be on the walls of a museum, and more broadly, you know, maybe, you know, knowing that your images are being circulated, you know, very broadly, and actually, this might be a good point to mention that a major publication is coming out on Jess's work, just released by Mac Publishers. So yet another kind of venue in which these images will circulate, which is something, you know, I can't quite imagine myself what that might feel like. So I'm really curious. So Shira, if you jump in.
For sure. I look at this a little bit from the lens of a historian. So is that it's like it's really not lost on me the context that this work is important in. There's the conversation of these photos is spectacularly different from like where we've been. And by that, like for myself as a queer body being gazed upon in a museum setting, even in like the most contemporary terms, I'm talking like from Kathy Opier, Wolfgang Tillmans, or even like Nan Golden, who photographed just what they believe is this spectacle of queer identity. They're all investigating a conversation where like queer and trans bodies though are like salacious still and spectacular still, and uncovering our bodies to portray as beautiful is has not been the conversation for so long. So in these photographs, these like, for me, and I mean this as a compliment, they're like very banal, and they're parts of the fabric of what we know and how we fit in to society already. It doesn't necessarily mean that we're not like still salacious in and charged in new stories, but in a museum, our history is so significantly different. So for me to be a part of that conversation that goes beyond the content in the news or the content of discrimination, it has this opportunity to reveal the humanity of myself and of all of the people in the gallery walls that I'm in conversation with. Just that very like banal lived experience of existing and being seen in a very beautiful intimacy. And it's quite remarkable. It's also like really incredibly important to me from a political perspective, specifically from the work that I'm in, that the history of my trans body has been criminalized for so long and long before I've been around, and still today in the Midwest is still doesn't have the same value as most other people. So being able to present that intimacy and vibrancy outside of the political threat in a Midwestern museum to show these collection to people who are of the more broad, general, typical Midwestern folks is a really important conversation for me to be having today. And I'm like really honored that I get to be a part of that through my photograph of being seen and not just as somebody who's like explaining the exhibition to other people.
Wow, that's an amazing answer. Thank you. Thank you for that. It's really, really wonderful to hear.
Yeah, so for me, I think the story that really kind of like encompasses like everything for me for this exhibit was, I got like this text one day. I think it was like in November, and it was from like a close family friend. And he was just like, yo, like I just took my daughter to the museum and we saw you in the space. And it was just like, it's kind of like an out of the blue text because we don't really talk that often. But he was like, yeah, we were just walking through and I showed my daughter and we were just like amazed seeing you there. And it was incredible. And that moment for me was really cool just because, you know, knowing that someone that knows me personally is able to see myself on the walls and is able to like identify with me, you know, I just feel like it makes her world a lot larger as far as like the spaces that she can be in, where she feels represented. And she's also able to see specifically a Black body at rest. And so that was just like a very special moment. And, you know, I think that it's incredible that this is, I don't know, you know, sometimes it's kind of unreal to think that I'm in this space that, you know, I grew up walking into, you know, whether on like a school field trip or whatever other visit, but, you know, to be in this space and to have people who are able to identify and, you know someone who's in their community is really special.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing that. I just want to add that, and maybe this is obvious at this point in the conversation, but the idea of representation is really important to me as an artist, especially within a museum space. And I love how you each have stories about how that manifests with your particular identity in really powerful ways. And it's something that I'm deeply committed to as an artist. So I love hearing kind of how that played out for each of you in this particular space.
Jessica, are you available to read some questions from the chat?
Yes. One second here. Yes, yeah, so we have quite a few questions here. Two of them are asking a similar thing. So really this is directed to Collin or Shira, and Shira. Did Jess's work as a portrait artist reveal to either of you something about yourself that you may not have known before? Mm-hmm. And then the other question is, in what way did the experience of being the subject of portraits change the way you see yourself? Mm-hmm. So I don't know if who would like to take that first, Collin or Shira?
I guess
I'm gonna call on Collin. Collin.
For sure. Yeah, I think it's really offered me a moment to just pause and, you know, thinking. I'm someone who likes to think like years ahead, like 2040, 2050. What does it look like to be able to look back at these photographs and, you know, just see, be able to remember where my headspace was, remember where, you know, my growth and my practice of rest and, you know, comfort, where that was at. So yeah, just being able to take that moment to pause, to also take some time to not be the person that is in control of pressing the shutter button, but also, you know, being in that space where, you know, I have someone who is incredible at making portraits there to, you know, kind of document me in a way that's really special. So I think that's what that was for me.
I think I'll echo that almost perfectly, the way Collin mentioned. I think that there is just a history in being able to look back on where we've been and to take note of the time that was spent engaging in these conversations or this time with another person. It's not necessarily taught me something very tangible about myself that I could say like is different, but it allows this memory to exist and like grow and have a life in my own understanding of how I am comfortable in the world and how I release control a little bit. Yeah.
Let's see, next question. The gallery installation at SLAM creates a wonderful experience for the viewer that seems more than the sum of its parts. Jess, did you choose works for this exhibit so that the installation within the space became a singular piece?
That's a great question. Thank you so much. Yes, absolutely. So I, from a technical, practical point of view, I selected the works in the gallery in collaboration with Hannah and Eric. And we were actually fortunate to have, what was it, Hannah, 2 years to plan this show. We had a really long time to work on it. And so I actually was able to meet with them early enough in the process that I could then go back and make more portraits. So the process of putting the exhibition together was very collaborative. But I did very much think of the edit and the sequence as being very lyrical. So we laid out the space in a particular order. We varied the sizes of the photographs. The image to image is linked either by color or gesture or emotion. So we spent a lot of time thinking about how a viewer would move throughout that space and how you would experience the arc of all 20 photographs and not just one singular photograph. So I did very much think about that. And, you know, I know Eric mentioned the book. I have my singular advanced copy here. And I won't, you know, make you look at my whole book, but I was trying to find one where it's, I'll try to find a spread, hang on. But we very much sequenced the book in a similar way to be kind of lyrical. Here's a good example. Like putting things together based on color or mood. And I was thinking about this as a visual poem, and in a way the exhibition was structured very similarly. It's meant to be centered around emotion and a kind of visceral kind of feeling in each photograph.
excuse me. Let's see. Oh goodness. Jess, are there any technical resources you like to use when photographing people? For example, specific lenses, external lighting, certain editing processes, etc. Also, incredible work.
Thank you. My equipment is really minimal. I trained on a 4x5 view camera and I used that for about 10 years. So I got used to working on a tripod with natural light. I do photograph digitally now. I have a digital medium format camera. I come from the school of thought of having one lens and moving your body. So I have one camera and one lens and a tripod. My lighting equipment exists, My lighting equipment includes only a reflector, which I pull out maybe 5% of the time. So I work pretty minimally in terms of equipment. Really for me, what I'm reacting to is the person and obviously the light and the space.
Let's see. So actually these are for Jess. So sorry, I was looking for ones for Collin and Shira, but we have a lot of questions for Jess right now. So I'm trying to make sure I read this correctly. Do you see these engaging portraits, so diverse and poignant and empowered, by being a series in the photographic tradition, most of which were spouses? So I guess
I got the question until the spouses part.
Yeah, I'm not sure. So maybe just as thinking of things as a series or like a diptych or triptychs, or maybe that's kind of, I'm not really sure, but.
Sure. Yeah. I wish Anne could pop on and expand.
They may be able to type it in. So
yeah. And if you could cite more, go ahead. I'd be super curious. I guess I'm coming at the question from thinking about the works as part of a series. Maybe that's the way to approach it. But, you know, I think for me, I am thinking with each individual portrait about representing a certain person or, you know, representing couples together. That is really, really essential. And so I do think this work as a whole is strengthened by being in dialogue with other work, and that the accumulation of the work is stronger in series. I also, maybe this is hitting on the spouse aspect of this question. You know, I do very much think about representing queerness and queer couples in a longer photographic lineage in dialogue with a photographic history. And not everyone in this work is queer, not everyone in this exhibition is queer, but there are images where it is very visibly queer. And so I do very much think about that, both in the work itself and also in the museum space. And that's one thing that's been really amazing about this particular exhibition, is seeing people's reaction to queer couples in this particular museum in this particular moment. So yes, I do very much think about how the portraits are speaking to representation and in dialogue with a longer history, and also thinking about how they're in dialogue with painting, which my work is really heavily influenced by painting. We haven't talked about that a lot today, but I think it's really evident in, you know, the portrait of Collin in the Red Room, for example, and even in some of the gestures and in the images of Shira. So I think of also a dialogue with painting and, you know, who was represented and who was not represented. And that's a really significant part of my work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I apologize. We're not going to be able to get to all these questions. We are pretty much coming up on time, but I want to thank all of you for being here and for sharing all of this with us. I really do hope that people are able to come once the museum reopens, that they're able to come in and see the show. You know, we can. It's wonderful to be able to see the works on a screen, but it's even better to see them in person. And so I also just want to thank everyone who joined us today to watch. That's we appreciate that very much. And looking ahead to next week, we have two virtual programs that you can register for if you're interested. The first is on Wednesday, February 2nd at 7 p.m. Central, where we will be joined by Australian artist Judy Watson, who is a member of the first generation of Aboriginal artists to employ the conventions of studio-based fine art practice to examine contemporary identity and historical trauma. Then on Thursday, February 3rd at noon, we are kicking off Black History Month with an art speaks about the artist Elizabeth Catlett by one of the museum's Romare Bearden graduate fellows, Dylan Stevenson. So you can register for these programs and a lot more at slam.org/events. And thank you again, everyone, and have a wonderful day.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Collin and Shira.
Thank you, Collin and Shira.